It's a chap who's working in an abattoir. He's got his hand severed.
1, 2, 3.
An almost complete amputation.
It's through like that. It's going to be completely mushed.
The biggest risk for us is blood loss. My concern is that the tissue is not viable.
He may end up losing the head.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you get my back?
We're gonna staple your head back together.
There is a possibility he might die.
Would you rescue me?
Royal Melbourne Emergency, Kim speaking.
A call is coming through from an air ambulance flying to the Royal Melbourne Hospital from rural Victoria with a man who suffered a horrifying accident at work.
It's all happening.
Meeting Sheridan.
Sheridan, I've also got a helicopter coming, but it's a chap who's working in an abattoir. He's got his hand crushed.
Amputated?
Yes, severed at the wrist. It's hanging on by a piece of string.
Deputy Director of Emergency, Dr. Steve Pinkers, is starting his afternoon shift as the paramedics call in.
I can get a flavour for what the day is going to be like by how busy the place is already. But as to what will actually happen during the day, what cases I'll see, what patients will present, I don't know exactly what I'm going to be doing every day. That's emergency medicine.
...26-year-old Chung got his right hand caught in a conveyor belt at an abattoir. And it's been almost entirely ripped away from his wrist. Chung arrived in Australia from Taiwan just a few weeks ago. He's conscious but doesn't speak much English.
Do you speak Mandarin?
Yeah.
Because supposedly this patient only speaks Mandarin.
So I can speak Mandarin too.
Oh, perfect. Yeah. That worked out well.
OK.
G'day, mate.
So we'll get him over first, guys, before we do anything.
Paramedics and the emergency team move quickly to get critically injured Chung onto the trauma bed.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He's a 26-year-old fellow. It's been described to me that he has put his hand up in a conveyor belt type chain arrangement and he's sustained an almost complete amputation of the right hand at the wrist. I believe it's hanging on by some skin only. I haven't taken it down to have a look at myself. It was really well dressed. First AV crews on scene found him to be conscious. They washed it out, dressed it, bandaged, gave him some pain relief, called us, and we're here.
Okay, thank you very much.
The biggest risk for us is blood loss. Because a chain conveyor is not exactly a sharp piece of equipment, it crushes as much and tears as much as cuts. We knew that he'd been working in an abattoir. We knew that he'd had a hand injury. We didn't know the level of the injury. Was it in the hand? Was it the wrist? We didn't know whether it would start bleeding again when we took the dressings down to have a look at it.
So what I propose we do is we x-ray the limb.
Yes.
Have a look what we can see from the outside. Is x-ray here? Can we do a shoot through of the limb in dressing? Then once we've seen that, we've got plastics and ortho here. We'll undo it once, OK? Daniel, how is his pain?
Nurse Daniel Pang translates for Chung as the trauma team prepares to x-ray his bandaged hand.
9 out of 10 pain.
9 out of 10 pain.
Let's keep going some...
Yeah, so you've got a bad injury to your arm.
Just going to take an x-ray.
You're really comfortable.
Let's have a look.
The x-ray reveals a shocking injury.
It is.
Yeah.
It's the hand rather than the wrist, isn't it? So it's through here. It's a single limb injury, which is basically through about that level, through like that. But with that sort of level of injury, it would be debatable whether that's going to survive. So we'll do our very best, but he may end up losing the head.
Royal Melbourne receiving.
Thomas here with a 19-year-old female, history of arthritis.
Dr. Bjorn Makin has been an emergency doctor at the Royal Melbourne for 5 years.
Royal Melbourne receive, we'll see you in 5 minutes.
He's got just minutes to prepare for a young woman arriving by ambulance who's having a severe asthma attack.
We need to get the non-invasive set up and I need nursing staff.
Yep, they're going into R6.
Okay, cool. I'll go and set up there. We should set up for what the worst case scenario is and then hope for the best. So we'll just meet it with an appropriate crew to be able to deal with sort of someone who's crashing. The bed's not made and we haven't got an NIV in there, so I'll need a...
So maybe we'll have to do it in here.
Yeah, just nebulised salbutamol, Atrovent.
With so many patients in emergency, resources are overstretched. As the paramedics arrive, Dr. Bjorn is making the bed.
This patient is critically unwell and we need to get onto bed, and if I can facilitate that, that's great. And if I have to do the bedpan or wipe the bum or do whatever's necessary, then that is absolutely my job, and I truly believe that. OK, it's going to be a sharp movement. 1, 2, 3.
Gabrielle is a 19-year-old shop assistant who's only recently developed severe asthma.
Focus on the breathing, OK? Don't stress. We'll get things sorted out.
She's been hospitalised more than a dozen times in the last 2 years.
So, Gabrielle, do you feel like your breathing's gotten better since we started with the mist, or do you think it's gotten worse?
Mm-hmm.
Gotten worse, has it?
The ambulance paramedics had given her steroids very early on in order to try and reduce the swelling. That's the mist. The basic treatment of asthma was a nebulised medication to try and target the lungs specific.
Were you at work when all this started? So you still managed to get to work, huh?
Gabrielle took a break from work to buy batteries for her portable nebulizer when she collapsed in the chemist.
When you've been in the ICU, have you ended up having to have a tube put down to breathe for you? Once before. It's pretty bad, isn't it?
If Gabrielle's attack isn't brought under control soon, the next step is to intubate by putting a breathing tube down her throat to pump oxygen into her lungs.
Just gonna have a listen, okay?
The reason that intubation is not a good idea is because it doesn't fix the problem.
Deep breath for me.
In an asthmatic, it is really the intervention of last resort.
Okay.
And there's a bit of wheeze, but there's quite a lot of coarse crackles there too. Have you been having any fevers over the last few days or weeks?
A virus.
Virus. You've had a bit of a virus, have you? Have you been taking any antibiotics or anything like that? No, okay. We're going to go into flu precautions. Can we just get face masks on, everyone? She's really had quite a lot of therapy so far, and it doesn't look like it's really making much difference. I'm a bit worried about you because you're just working so hard that you're going to get tired, OK? And you know that when you get tired, that's when you end up sort of with that tube breathing for you, and that's not necessarily the greatest thing in the world.
In essence, what she's doing is she's breathing through a straw, and even a healthy young woman will eventually become exhausted. She will no longer be able to generate the forces necessary to breathe through that straw, and she will very rapidly decompensate and potentially die.
You're still going to hang in there? Don't panic. Just try and breathe with the machine. You're doing a great job. You just focus on that breathing, OK?
At the Royal Melbourne Emergency, 19-year-old shop assistant Gabrielle is battling a life-threatening asthma attack and she's not responding to drug treatment.
I'm worried about you because you're just working so hard.
Dr. Bjorn Makin fears she's in danger of complete respiratory failure.
I'm very concerned because, especially finding out that she's previously been intubated and been in ICU on multiple of those occasions, would mean that she has a very severe form of asthma.
We're just going to do an X-ray, OK?
In my mind, I'm thinking of all the things I should be doing before I take the most extreme intervention and intubate her, but also kind of preparing for that possible intervention that needs to occur.
Okay, big breath in, breathe normally.
Dr. Bjorn X-rays Gabrielle's lungs. The X-ray result is surprising, and Dr. Bjorn decides to change treatment.
Well, that's unexpectedly good. But her lungs are pretty clear for all their crackles.
This mask we're going to pop on you. Now, the theory is it pushes the air in and helps you breathe a bit more and gives your lungs a rest, OK, because you're looking very tired. It fits very tightly, though. Can you feel it pushing the air in?
Does it feel like you're not getting enough breath, is it? Sort of, OK. Is it just that you have to fight to get a breath in, is that right?
Yeah.
Gabrielle's still struggling to breathe with the oxygen mask.
What we're trying to do there is we're trying to reduce the work of breathing because she's going to get very rapidly get exhausted.
She's just tight, tight, tight. I mean, the adrenaline, I think, is the next step. So we should start the adrenaline infusion.
The intravenous adrenaline should keep Gabrielle's airway open and relax the muscles to her lungs.
Do you feel better? Sort of, OK.
If the adrenaline doesn't work, Dr. Bjorn may be forced to take over Gabrielle's breathing.
It's a very fine balance of intervening at the right time, but not too early and not too late. What I'm thinking is about when is the right time to intervene.
As night falls, another air ambulance is coming into land on the Royal Melbourne Hospital's rooftop.
Hi there, it's Michael here in emergency. We have a trauma coming in with some portable x-rays when they come around, so...
Dr. Michael Dunn's preparing for a seriously injured man who's been crushed by a quad bike.
Oh, he's some ketamine and propofol drawn off in case we need... He's in absolute agony.
50-year-old Len was out with a group of mates having his first ever quad bike ride when he crashed at high speed. He was catapulted over the handlebars and trapped under the 300-kilo bike when it landed on top of him.
With quad bike or motorbike accidents, we are concerned about spinal injuries, a significant head injury, because the patient's not harnessed in like they would be in a car. So something we need to be particularly wary of.
Hi, guys. Do you want to do a hands-off handover and just get the story?
No, no worries.
Len's injuries may be very serious, and his wife and children are unaware he's been airlifted to hospital.
This is Len. He's been riding a quad bike around about 4 o'clock today with some friends when he states he was going around about 75 kilometres an hour when his front wheels have impacted a ditch, which has caused the quad bike to sort of flip up and throw him forward from the quad bike. We believe that he's then landed on his head with an impact that's quite significant, causing his helmet to actually crack.
Oftentimes, the knee-jerk reaction is to jump in and start examining the patient and checking them head to toe. Handover is when we get a full story about the patient and what the paramedics have found. Without the actual story to give a context, things can get missed.
He's got significant deformity open to his left shoulder, significant pain to his central spinal region around T1.
Is that all right?
Hello, my name's Alison. I'm on the trauma doc. This wind's going to move you across, man.
1, 2, 3.
Well done,
then. Left shoulder, possibly clavicle or anterior dislocation, back and head injury. GCS-15, hemodynamically stable, chest, abdo, pelvis fine.
All right, Alice is just going to pop in and have a quick listen to your heart and lungs, and I'm going to do an ultrasound at the same time, OK? Keeping that head nice and still for us.
Taking nice deep breaths. Mass, OK?
Whenever we have someone coming in with a high-speed accident, our main concerns are life-threatening injuries. Things we'll be looking for would be fluid around the heart, collapsed lung, some bleeding around the liver or inside the abdominal cavity.
Any pain here in the pelvis? No.
Good air entry. Noggin in your head?
Shoulder, you think that's...
It's not a good feel of the clavicle.
Dr. Michael begins examining Len's injured shoulder.
Sore there, is it? There.
From examining Len, we can tell that there's some deformity around the collarbone, so the x-ray will help guide us to see exactly what the level of injury is.
Yeah, he's fractured mid-clavicle there.
Yeah.
Whenever someone gets a significant impact to their side, either the shoulder is going to be injured or the collarbone will take the brunt of the force. So it is quite a painful injury because whenever you take a deep breath in, the collarbone will move and that will cause pain.
The x-ray confirms a badly broken collarbone, but it doesn't show if Len has spinal injuries.
Hey, what's the sorest bit at the moment?
It's the middle of my back. I don't know what's wrong.
Who was with you at the time? Just keep your head nice and still, OK? You're doing a good job.
Two friends.
OK. And what happened there? Did they help you walk, or did you have to wait for an ambulance?
Yeah.
Couldn't get up.
Well, my legs are good.
Back's got me a little concerning. He hasn't moved since.
Can you wiggle your fingers in this left hand from the face? Does anything feel numb at the moment in the hand?
Yes.
In this situation, we're very concerned about Len's spine, particularly given the degree of pain he's in.
Hey, sir.
Yeah. So, whatever we can.
We're going to need to get dressings on it.
Yeah.
So, let's get some bandages, some Betadine in case it's mucky.
In Trauma Bay 2, abattoir worker Chung's right hand has been almost severed when it was caught in machinery.
Because a chain conveyor crushes as much and tears as much as cuts, my concern is that the tissue is not viable.
Dr. Steve Pincus is preparing to unwrap the bandage to see if the young man's hand can be saved.
Guys, before you start, can we just get some pain relief on board? So give it a minute and you can keep doing cutting your dressings off, just don't take the primary dressing.
Removing the dressing is very dangerous for the patient.
The key thing is we don't want blood loss. And the more times you disturb the dressing, the more chance you are going to make it start bleeding again.
Let's get the tourniquet on in case we need it. We won't do it up, we'll just put it on loose. Look, it's there, it's not going to do any harm, but it's just there. It's just there. If it suddenly starts hosing, it's there. It's going to be completely mushed. OK, go for it, guys.
Chung's hand has been cut through and is literally hanging by a piece of skin. It's a devastating injury for the young abattoir worker.
Let's pop some Betadine on.
Doctors from plastic surgery and orthopaedics examine the catastrophic injury before quickly rewrapping it.
Daniel, can you help the plastics reg consent him?
Chung is being prepared for urgent surgery.
When did you last eat?
Nurse Daniel is translating for Chung as plastic surgeon Dr. Libby Shakula explains the risks of the operation.
Okay, how's he feeling at the moment? Can he talk?
Yep.
So, we need to go to surgery. Can you tell him that? So just to let him know, with this sort of injury, the main aim is to explore everything and see what is feasible to repair. It's a pretty bad injury. Usually when it's a twisting type of injury rather than a sharp cut, it's a bit more difficult for putting things back together. So we'll do our best to get the blood supply flowing again and to stabilise all the bones. He may need several other operations. The worst case scenario is if that does not work, that he will lose his hand. Has he been in Australia before? Okay. And does he have any family or friends in Australia?
At the Royal Melbourne Emergency, abattoir worker Chung has just been told he may lose his hand after it was almost severed by machinery at work.
He's a foreign visitor out here to work, to earn money. He's by himself, he has no social supports. It's a horrible situation for him.
I asked him about where's your next of kin. He told me that his family back in Taiwan. So, and then I asked, do you want us to contact them? Because we got a social worker here. And he told me, no, I don't want them to worry about me while I'm in Australia.
Alone and facing a major operation, 26-year-old Chung is about to be rushed to theatre, where surgeons will try to reattach his severed hand.
It's really hard when he doesn't have any supports. It makes it very, very difficult. The problem is partly the level of injury, but also the nature of the injury. It's crushed rather than cut. And so with that crushing, you get damage to the lining of the blood vessels, and then what happens? You get clotting. And so it's much, much harder to repair the tissues. So I would have thought he has a very high risk of losing that hand.
Hello, hello.
Lucy Stranger has been an emergency nurse for 10 years, the last five at the Royal Melbourne.
I'm just going to run off. I'll be back in a minute.
Before, like, I open the curtain, I try and take a breath, try and remember that this is probably one of their worst days, or at least a day where they're feeling uncertain and probably insecure. And then I'll try and find a common connection with them.
Any pain at the minute, Tone?
Nothing special.
73-year-old Tony has been admitted to emergency complaining of chest pains.
Nice uggies.
Yeah. I've got an ugly hat too.
Oh, kidding.
I didn't have to be wearing it. I was just sitting outside reading a book, as is my wont. I suddenly just developed chest pains. Bad. At my age, that could be nasty.
Has it happened before?
No. Well, not to this degree, put it this way.
The retired school teacher doesn't have a history of heart problems, but he has a terrible cough that's getting worse.
Pardon me.
I was going to have a listen to your lungs, so if you have a cough, go for it. Cough now. Take a nice deep breath in and out.
Sorry.
You all right, darling? I am getting someone to have a look at your ECG and we've sent your bloods and we'll keep an eye on you. Can you let us know if you get any of that pain back or anything odd or funny? How does that sound? Plan?
Nurse Lucy consults with Dr. Glenn Harrison.
He has had 3 days of a productive cough prior to this. He's been treated for a chest infection.
I'll go chat to him.
Yes.
I'm Glenn, one of the doctors.
Hi, good morning, Tony.
You've got a slightly abnormal cardiograph. What heart problems have you had before?
Well, none.
None.
Tony's heart test shows something is wrong, but the cause is still a mystery.
We're going to roll you onto your side and have a feel of your back, all right?
Back in trauma, Dr. Michael Dunn's seriously injured patient, Len, is lucky to be alive after a high-speed ride with mates went horribly wrong.
Now, this will hurt.
The father of two was riding a quad bike when he hit a ditch and was thrown into the air, landing on his head.
One, two, three.
He was pinned under the bike and has suspected back injuries.
Is there anything sore at the back of your neck?
Yeah, very sore. Yeah.
So the main thing was at the base of your neck?
C7, yeah. You're pretty sore over the base of the neck there at the spine. A little concern there might be a crack there. You let us do all the moving. One, two, three.
We're concerned about a spinal injury. The worry is that the bone may be unstable and that any movement he may do will actually cause some injury to the spinal cord or surrounding nerves. So it's quite important that we keep Glenn completely straight and immobilized until we can ascertain, is there any significant unstable injury?
If we could just give CT a call and let them know we're coming around.
Dr. Michael fears that Len's spinal cord may be damaged and he could be paralysed permanently.
Do you quad bike a lot, do you?
No, motocross. Two-wheelers.
We were short one motorbike. I decided to hand my bike over to a friend and, I rode the four-wheelie.
Bad decision.
This has obviously been a very traumatic injury for Len.
Until we get this collar on and get the orthopedic surgeons, I want to keep your head basically and back flat.
While we do focus on the treatment and the medical side of things, it's also important to see that this is going to affect their life moving forward. So a large aspect of our job is to be able to reassure patients and get them on the right track.
Men were watching you the whole time because mm-hmm. they need us urgently. There's a microphone in the machine, okay?
I suspect that he might have a fracture of his lower cervical spine, which is the base of the neck. And given the mechanism, the fact that he was going 75K and came off, there is a chance he may have something in the brain.
Does it feel like you're not getting enough breath, is it?
This mask, the theory is it pushes the air in and helps you breathe a bit more and gives your lungs a rest.
Dr. Bjorn Makin's asthma patient, Gabrielle, is struggling to breathe and has been given adrenaline to try to relax her airway. Her worried parents, John and Rita, have just arrived to be with their youngest daughter.
And what we do now is leave things for half an hour, okay? We'll watch her very closely and then we'll have a chat after that, okay?
Gabrielle messaged her mum from the ambulance after collapsing in a chemist near her work. Visiting emergency has become a familiar and frightening routine for the family.
Nothing you can do. Nothing. It's just frustrating. Oh, she's a good kid. Oh, she's not a kid anymore, but yeah, sorry. Oh, she's good. We got the good one, yeah. Except for this, yeah. Yeah. We're just, you know, hoping that miraculously that it might go as quick as it came.
It's the shop assistant's 14th visit to emergency since her first asthma attack 2 years ago.
I have three children. I think being a parent gives you an insight into what people are feeling when that loved one of theirs is critically unwell.
Dr. Bjorn suspects there could be another trigger for Gabrielle's frequent asthma attacks.
Sometimes anxiety is part of the issue. Like, if you're anxious, you're going to breathe faster, and if you breathe faster, you don't ventilate as well, and so it can be a sort of spiral. There we go, perfect timing. How are we doing?
I cannot see anybody being anything but anxious when they are struggling to breathe to that extent.
Let's have a listen at your back, my dear. Deep breaths.
Dr. Bjorn decides to keep Gabrielle in hospital overnight to monitor her breathing.
The classic anxiety versus asthma.
At the main desk, he's catching up with his wife, Dr. Maya Cubitt.
So I keep having to validate my belief that it's actually asthma. And yes, there might be a bit of anxiety, but she's pretty sick.
Anxious for a reason.
Yes, exactly, you know.
Yeah. Maya and I met in our first year of medical school, and Maya is often the person who is my sounding board, my go-to person.
So we're going to bring her around for a CT scan now, okay?
50-year-old Len was riding a quad bike for the first time when he crashed at very high speed. The father of two was trapped under the 300-kilo bike when it landed on top of him. Dr. Michael Dunn believes Len could have life-changing injuries.
There, he's coming through the back.
I'm wearing a spinous fracture.
Yeah, he does.
The CT scan reveals he's broken his back in four places, fractured his ribs, and punctured his lung.
Len has multiple fractures to his spine high up and also around the mid-back area. I think that given the fact that Len went over the handlebars and landed on his head, that potentially could have led to a significant head injury. And he's extremely lucky he doesn't have any neurological deficits, having had such a significant hit.
But it seems that you cracked the bones in the spine, so I want to keep your head and back flat.
Len's fractured back is being protected with a collar. If one of the broken bones dislodges, it could crush his spinal cord.
Yeah, that's perfect. So we'll get the orthopaedic surgeons in to see you, okay? Your job is to keep taking deep breaths in.
If you don't take full breaths in and out, parts of your lungs won't fully expand and you can get a chest infection.
And if your pain gets very bad, just put your hand up and we'll get you some painkillers, okay? All right, come on.
Len retired 4 years ago and regularly goes off-road dirt biking. But a generous gesture to a mate has changed his life forever.
I decided to hand my bike over to a friend. And, yeah, I rode the four-wheeler, hit a ditch, and just got catapulted off it, and the thing just rolled. And when I stacked it, I couldn't feel my back, and I couldn't move this arm, and I just thought there was something bad wrong. I knew something was wrong.
His son Jesse is on his way, while Len waits to hear if surgeons will have to operate.
But I shouldn't have been riding that four-wheeler. First time and last time.
Good man.
In a treatment bay, nurse Lucy Stranger is looking after 73-year-old Tony, who's waiting on test results for his mysterious chest pain and cough.
If you need me, call me.
You've got an octopus.
I do.
Why?
Because I thought it looked cool. And I wanted to be cool.
You have anything to do with octopi?
I grew up on the sea.
You did? Where? Mm-hmm.
There's lots of sea-themed things. I actually grew up there, in Tasmania, down near the Iron Pot.
Mm. Jeepers.
My parents live on a yacht.
Mm.
I think my favourite kind of patients are ones with brilliant stories and have great chat. When a patient wants to get involved in that, I love it.
It's a personal preference of mine not to see girls with tattoos.
You're talking about my tattoos. I don't care if people have an issue with my tattoos. Of course people are going to ask about them. They're everywhere. It'd be really rude and stupid of me to not expect it. And it creates conversation. Aren't they lovely?
Can I pass on that? If you're going to have yourself graffiti...
I wouldn't say graffiti, I'd say artwork. Say turned into a gallery, a walking gallery.
Emergency doctor Ali Al-Habubi has Tony's test results, which may reveal the cause of his pain.
The chest x-ray is good, mm-hmm. So all your numbers are fine.
Terrific.
Most likely it's a muscular issue, just with the excessive coughing that you've been having the past few days.
All right.
So everything's fine. Any questions?
Can I go home now?
Yes. Yes. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Thanks, Thomas. Thank you.
How about that?
Winner.
Yeah.
Happy?
I love making connections with strangers. I think that's really beautiful and that's where it's really rewarding.
Listen.
Yeah?
You can't go on your feet over
here. Special socks, do you want a pair? You can have them. I'll steal them for you.
New pair, though. Present for teaching me about boats.
Well, there you go.
Oh, well, trying. Look at that. They're even wrapped. Gift wrapped.
Goodness, look at that.
With a clean bill of health and a new pair of socks, Tony is good to go home.
Call me if you need me.
Dr. Yana Alexander always wanted to work in emergency, thanks to Hollywood heartthrob George Clooney.
I was a big ER fan, so I think that was what did it for me in the end. I just really liked that show, and it kind of showed that side of medicine that was really unpredictable and fast-paced and exciting, and I thought that would be a good job to do. And that's why I picked it.
All right.
Hi,
Naomi. Now we're going to do all the work for you, OK?
Hello, I'm one of the doctors.
Hello.
Hello, love.
I'm just going to shut my eyes while you do
what
you're
doing. You shut your eyes, do what you need to do. I'm just going to hold your head here.
Dr. Yana's patient, 42-year-old Naomi, crashed her car at high speed following a nightmare close encounter.
One, two, three, and across.
Oh.
This is lovely Naomi, travelling 100 kilometres per hour when she's seen a spider across her steering wheel. She's tried to blow it away off her hands. And from doing that, she's lost control of the car. It started swerving. She's then collected, you know, the safety barriers on the side of the road in the medium strip. Her car has hit that and then it's become airborne and flipped onto its roof. I'll show you the car. Oh, I thought the roof might have had a little bit of intrusion, but actually it's maintained its height.
You poor thing, that's my biggest fear, is a spider in my car. Is it a big one?
It was actually a tiny one, but I blew it, and I don't know what happened, whether the car skidded and hit something then or what happened, but it just went...
Oh my goodness, you poor thing.
When someone's crashed their car at 100Ks, the first thing I think about is major head injury. And then you're thinking about spines.
We're just going to have a look at you from top to toe, OK? Yeah, and I'm going to do an ultrasound of your tummy.
Naomi was hanging upside down until passers-by helped her get out of the car.
OK, I'm just going to have a quick feel of your tummy, my darling. Any pain at all here?
No.
OK, Naomi, just cold jelly on your tummy. Just having a look behind your bladder, OK? Is there any pain at all down here?
No.
Good.
The ultrasound we can do at the bedside can tell us straight away if there's bleeding. It won't always tell us where that bleeding's coming from. This lady's had a high-speed injury with a flip, and so all those rotational forces make it quite likely that she's got a spinal injury.
I'm just going to have a look at your legs. Any pain at all here?
No.
Any pain at all along here?
No.
The examination isn't showing any immediate red flags, but Dr. Yana needs Naomi to have a full body scan for possible facial and internal injuries.
Can I have a wee look in this eye here before it swells up, okay?
Facial fractures can be significant, especially if you get them around the eye. If there's a significant facial fracture, you're also more suspicious of intracranial, so injury to the brain. And so that's something that we'll have to look very closely for.
Were you able to walk at the scene, weren't you, Naomi?
Naomi crashed her car at 100 k's an hour after she got a massive fright from a spider crawling across her steering wheel.
I couldn't imagine anything worse. I don't know how I'd react in that situation, to be honest.
She has serious facial injuries, and Dr. Yana arranges a CT scan of Naomi's head and spine.
I think she might have facial fractures.
News of Naomi's eight-legged hitchhiker is a hot topic at the nurse's station.
Have you seen the video? It's on Facebook, and there's a car at the traffic lights, and they can see a spider crawling in the back of someone's, like, no, in the cracks at the back.
Spiders are terrifying and gross.
Naomi's CT scan results should show how much damage the spider has caused.
Back and head injury.
Dr. Michael's patient, Len, was airlifted to hospital after a high-speed quad bike accident in remote bushland. An experienced dirt bike rider, it was the 50-year-old's very first time on a quad bike, and it ended in disaster. The father of two broke his spine in four places, fractured his ribs, and punctured his lung.
I guess they wouldn't give you the remote to adjust the bed just in case you wound up doing something.
It's now been 5 days since his trip to emergency, and Len is now recovering in a ward with son Jesse by his side.
I thought I was dead. I thought I was going to die. That thing rolled on top of me, that four-wheeler, like I was nothing, and I was just a bag of potatoes, and that was the, 250 or whatever, 300 kilograms smashing on top of you at the same time. It's not good.
Jesse's grateful his dad survived and that his injuries aren't much worse.
It's very terrible what's happened, but I'm super glad that he's still okay. He's the best dad I could ask for. Without him, we would be... I can't even imagine, honestly. He's absolutely everything to me. He's my best friend, he's my dad.
Fortunately for Len, doctors decided not to operate on his back.
I suspect Len will actually make quite a good recovery after this injury, but it'll be a long process. And I think with multiple broken bones, it's going to be a lot of pain and a lot of rehab involved. But I think he's come away quite lucky.
And what is Len looking forward to doing once he recovers?
Can I say this on TV? I'm so looking forward to scratching my bum. On my own, which would be good, yeah.
We're going to go into flu precautions. Can we just get face masks on, everyone?
Dr. Bjorn's asthma patient, Gabrielle, was kept overnight for observation after her 14th visit to emergency in 2 years. She was discharged the next day.
There's also good news for Naomi, who crashed and rolled her car when she was distracted by an unwelcome spider. Her scan results were clear and she was allowed to go home.
Just to add to the humiliation more, the spider was tiny, but I'm going to remember it as enormous and rearing up on its back legs with its fangs sticking out so I don't feel so silly.
When abattoir worker Chung came to emergency, his hand had been crushed and almost torn in half by a chain belt. Dr. Steve prepared the 26-year-old for emergency surgery in a bid to reattach his hand.
With that sort of level of injury, it would be debatable whether that's going to survive. So we'll do our very best, but he may end up losing the hand.
Why?
How have you been going?
Good.
Good. You're looking a bit better in yourself today.
Yeah.
4 weeks later, Chung is recovering from major surgery, which miraculously saved his hand.
All right, well, let's have a look and see what's happening under here. It's healing up well.
Today, Chung has returned to hospital for a procedure to clean up his wound. Although he's still got a long way to go, the early signs are good.
I think the fact that we know the hand has survived is a testament to the skill of the plastic surgical unit and the orthopaedic unit. The tissues were significantly crushed, and the fact that they have survived is really quite amazing.